we find an interesting scenario taking place in Numbers 13. And I'm going to jump around a little bit to different scriptures, so get your Bibles out today. It's kind of an expository teaching, all right? What we see here is we see a great analogy, a great reason for spiritual warfare. That's a popular theme today, spiritual warfare. And kind of became popular maybe 10 years ago, and we still hear a lot about it. Well, this is a good example of true spiritual warfare. We call it spying out the land. You go out and you get on to the devil's devices. Let's look at it here in chapter 13, just two verses. And the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, that's pretty succinct to me. The Lord spoke to Moses, and the Lord is speaking to all kinds of people today, but are we listening? Verse 2. Send men to spy out the land of Canaan, which I am giving to the children of Israel. From each tribe of their fathers you shall send a man, everyone a leader among them. Very succinct, very plain. The Lord said, I'm giving you the land. It's yours. Go possess it. And then we see something happening here. All of a sudden, the world standards kick in. And 10 of these 12 individuals are so influenced by each other that they end up contaminating an entire generation. When you hear me say, don't vote Republican or Democrat, vote God. Vote His standards. Because when you examine the philosophy of either party, many times it's not the philosophy or the standards that God would have set for us. And so the world's standards don't always add up to a whole lot. What do? We look to the Word. When all else fails, you do two things. You look to the Word and you pray. I said this Wednesday night at our prayer night, why do we always pray last? When all else fails, I better pray. When nothing has failed, you better pray. Prayer's a good thing. Prayer's not your enemy. Yeah, but you know what? When I look to the Word doesn't allow me to do what I want to do. Well, that's a good thing, not a bad thing. That's protective. So we look to the Word today, and we look at an individual's life whose name is Caleb. What was so good about Caleb? What is it we can learn from Caleb's life? Well, the first thing, he functioned under godly influence. Never try to move on your own. Look to the Word. Let the Word guide you. Let the Word be your defense. So he functioned under God's influence. Now I want you to look over at same chapter, 13, 30. Go all the way over to verse 30. He was a man under authority. There's no doubt in my mind that he had talked to Moses, and Moses had told him, God said we should go up and possess the land. Notice Caleb's response here. Then Caleb quieted the people before Moses and said, let us go up at once and take possession, for we are well able to overcome it. Now we got to really analyze this, because 10 of them had panicked. 10 of them were yelling their heads off. 10 of them had influenced each other, and now we're about to influence an entire generation yet Caleb and Joshua, they were two of that group that was chosen. But listen to what Caleb says. He didn't listen to the ten. He didn't listen to the outside people trying to influence him. Caleb quieted the people before Moses and said, "Let us go up at once and take possession, for we are well able to overcome him." Overcome the enemy, overcome the land, to overcome it. What was the difference? Trust. Caleb's trust in the Lord allowed him to try and quiet the people. Look at 30b. He was willing to go forth in God's power when others were not. That's what the power of God will do for you. When all else seems to be failing, it will lift you, quiet you, and send you forth to do God's mission. And we would do well today to listen to Caleb's words. I don't know what you're facing today, but you are well able to conquer it. Caleb realized that not only could the land be possessed, it could be conquered. We studied in the book of Revelations today, and one of the things that I brought out the fact is that I still believe the church will escape the tribulation and the great tribulation. John, writing the words of Jesus commending the faithful church, Philadelphia, says, "I will keep you out of that hour of temptation that the whole world is going through." That's the faithful church. That's us. Amen. And churches like us. But what we have to do as a people, we need to develop a "we are able" attitude. And the enemy is continually trying to destroy that concept. If I can get them to doubt this in the Word, and you know the devil as well as I do, the devil never stops at point A or point B or point C. The end result is death. He wants to destroy you. It's simple. Satan doesn't love us. Satan doesn't give a rip about us. He's a liar. How can you believe a liar? He's a thief. Now turn over to Numbers, the 14th chapter. I told you it was going to be quite a bit of scripture. And look at verse 5. "Then Moses and Aaron fell on their faces before all the assembly of the congregation of the children of Israel. But Joshua the son of Nun and Caleb the son of Jephunneh, who were among those who had spied out the land, tore their clothes. And they spoke to all the congregation of the children of Israel, saying, 'The land we passed through to spy out is an exceedingly good land. If the Lord delights in us, then He will bring us into this land and give it to us, a land which flows with milk and honey.'" Final verse. "Only do not rebel against the Lord, nor fear the people of the land, for they are our bread. Their protection has departed from them, and the Lord is with us. Do not fear them." They had the word of the Lord. They had the word of their leader. They both believed God. Their belief in God's abiding word saved them from the fate of this faithless generation. This entire generation is lost. They're gone. I pray to God that we have not raised a generation of faithless people that's going to take lap after lap after lap in the wilderness. Numbers, same chapter, verse 14. Now drop over to verse 28. I'm cutting through a lot of say to them, as I live, says the Lord, just as you have spoken in my hearing, so I will do to you. The carcasses of you who have complained against me shall fall in this wilderness. You don't get anything out of this message. There's a consequence for not adhering to the Word of God. All of you were numbered according to your entire number, from 20 years old and above, except for Caleb, the son of Jephunneh, and Joshua, the son of Nun. You shall by no means enter the land which I swore I would make you dwell in. But your little ones, whom you said would be victims, I will bring in, and they shall know the land which you have despised. I think that's about as far as we need to go. Now, let me go just a little bit farther. But as for you, your carcasses shall fall in this wilderness, and your sons shall be shepherds in the wilderness 40 years and bear the brunt of your infidelity until your carcasses are consumed in the wilderness. According to the number of days in which you spied out the land, 40 days, for each day you shall bear your guilt 1 year, namely 40 years, and you shall know my rejection. I, the Lord, have spoken this. I will surely do so to all this evil congregation who are gathered together against me. In this wilderness they shall be consumed. There they shall die. Now the men whom Moses sent to spy out the land, who returned and made all the congregation complain against him by bringing a bad report of the land, those very men who brought the evil report about the land died by the plague before the Lord. But Joshua, the son of Nun, and Caleb, the son of Jephunneh, remained alive of the men who went to spy out the land. What are we learning today? What do the 10 spies represent? They represent the ways of the world. The world's telling you in every way, shape, and form, television, sitcoms, books, movies, do it this way. That's the wrong way, church. If the hymns of the world go up, it doesn't necessarily mean, ladies, that the hymns of the church have to go up. And I'm not talking about hymns from the songbook here. I happen to believe that America is the greatest country in the world. We live in a great country. I want to get that straight. I love America. We probably still do more for the world than any individual country in the world. So in a sense, we could kind of liken ourselves to being in the Promised Land. They went into the Promised Land, but they never possessed it. They touched it. They even ate of its fruit. So how do we define? At every sin, the heart of every sin problem, there's a root. And when you identify the root, you can deal with the sin problem. Every time. I said this the other day. I said, what I deal with in the church, I deal with children in grown-up bodies. It's the truth. You talk to an adult long enough, immediately I'll perceive a root of bitterness. Say, this is what their problem is. But as gifts of the Holy Spirit, and they reside in you as well as me, you should be able to pick up on that yourselves. It's called discernment. And the greatest problem in America today, and I'm guilty of making statements, and they kind of resonate. Yeah, he's right. But I've said this over and over and over. The problem with America is that we are a fatherless generation. Oh, there's dads everywhere. but they're not fathers. And at the root of a fatherless generation is the root of abandonment. Abandonment makes you crazy. And Charlene and I, we talked about this not too long ago. You can have 8 kids in a family that went through the same abandonment problems and they'll all manifest themselves in 8 different directions. But there's problems. So we got to be wise as a church. We got to understand what Satan is trying to do to a nation. And to be abandoned as a fatherless generation. And you can abandon your children by not necessarily walking out of their lives. You can be in the home and spend 2, 3, 5 minutes at the most of quality time with your children. They'll feel abandoned. And so I looked at this and I said, what made these people do what they did? Moses had been leading them from the very beginning. They were there when the death angel passed through. They were there when the waters turned to blood. They were there for the lice. They were there for all of the plagues. You have Numbers 12? See, dissension always has a beginning. The dissension didn't start in the 13th chapter and the 14th chapter. It started in the 12th. Then Miriam and Aaron spoke against Moses because of the Ethiopian woman whom he had married, for he had married an Ethiopian woman. Well, they were racist. Yeah, you got it. They sure were. But more than that, they were rebellious. This rebellion in the camp of Israel had a beginning. The leadership went into rebellion. So they said, has the Lord indeed spoken only through Moses? Has he not spoken through us also? And the Lord heard it. The Lord hears it. Now the man Moses was very humble, more than all men who were on the face of the earth. Suddenly the Lord said to Moses, Aaron, and Miriam, come out, you three, to the tabernacle of meeting. So the three came out. Then the Lord came down in the pillar of cloud, stood in the door of the tabernacle, and called Aaron and Miriam, and they both went forward. Then he said, hear now my words. If there is a prophet among you, I, the Lord, make myself known to him in a vision. I speak to him in a dream. But he really clarifies something here. He says, not so with my servant Moses. He is faithful in all my house. I speak with him face to face, even plainly, and not in dark sayings. And he sees the form of the Lord. Why then were you not afraid to speak against my servant Moses? So the anger of the Lord was aroused against them, and he departed. And when the cloud departed from above the tabernacle, suddenly Miriam became leprous, as white as snow. Then Aaron turned towards Miriam, and there she was, a leper. So Aaron said to Moses, O my Lord, please do not lay this sin on us, in which we have done foolishly, in which we have sinned. Please do not let her be as one dead, whose flesh is half consumed when he comes out of his mother's womb. So Moses cried to the Lord, saying, please heal her, O God, I pray. Then he said to Moses, if her father had but spit in her face, would she not be shamed 7 days? In other words, she would have been considered unclean even if somebody would have spit on her and got spit on her. She would have been banned from the camp for 7 days. Let her be shut out of the camp 7 days. He said, that's the least I can do to her. And afterwards, she may be received again. So Miriam was shut out of the camp 7 days. And the people did not journey till Miriam was brought in again. And afterwards the people moved from Hazeroth and camped in the wilderness of Paran. That's where all this problem, this trouble started. Seek not the counsel of the ungodly. They will destroy your faith. They will tell you you can't be healed. They will tell you your wife or your husband doesn't understand you. What you need to do is find somebody else. So these 10 spies represent the standards of the world. But if you don't get anything out of the message today, remember this. Those that would choose the world standards always underestimate the power of God.
Amen.
That's what I'm afraid America is doing.
Amen.
We don't have to walk under the standards of God. No, we don't. Then we deal with His wrath. So they underestimated the power of God. We can disdain our leader. We can rebel. And God will look the other way. Well, Miriam found out, and so did Moses, that wasn't true. See, although God dwelt with the people, they doubted the power of His kingship. We never want to get to this point. That we wouldn't no longer know or feel the call of the Holy Spirit or the conviction of the Holy Spirit. We need to stop doubting His kingship. We need to stop doubting the power of His fellowship. I will never leave you or forsake you. Lo, I am with you to the ends of the world, of the age. Yes. You see, the point is, when you start doubting, there's no end. The enemy says, well, you know what? Just doubt this part of the word. And the next thing, you'll be doubting this part and this part. And this part, until finally you'll go, what happened to my faith? The enemy stole it. And we sat idly by and allowed it. I'm happy that I have good physicians, but I'm happier that I've got better intercessors that were praying for me and for Frankie and for Al and for Art. Every day of my life, God can do anything. They even came to doubt the power of Moses' leadership, to the point that Aaron and Miriam, who were almost co-leaders, they doubted it too. They challenged the legitimacy of Moses as the mouthpiece of the Lord. Are we doing that today in America? Are we looking at leadership, church leadership, mocking it, making fun of it, saying that it's not worth anything, but yet we're turning to the world? The most disrespected institution in America is the politician. And we keep trying to prove the definition of insanity as false. Doing the same thing over and over and over, expecting new results, is the definition of insanity. That's what we keep doing. We keep voting the same old back in, thinking they're going to change. You know what? You know when America will wake up one morning when they get up and they go, we are flat, busted, broke. Because they will not quit spending. They know we're broke. That's insanity. That's insane. That's like, I'm going to steal this guy's cell phone and your videotape and you filled out a questionnaire. Probably he drew a map. I live here. The fate of those who would follow the world reads like this: so close and yet so far. The fate of those who would follow God, Joshua, Caleb, they ceased from their lapse in the wilderness. So, if you're tired of taking laps in the wilderness, try God. Turn to God.